Hi, everyone. I hope you're having a great show. I'm here to talk to you about trends in surveillance, what's happening in the last few years, and what the big trends have been toward the newer CCTV systems. So with that, let me get over here to my screen. I'll share some stuff with you. And let's go. And there we got it. Okay. I think we're there. All right. So we'll give you an update today. If you don't know about me, my background is I've been doing this a long time. I'm an electrical engineer. I'm on the CEDIA board right now and got assigned this to the Technical Advisory Committee. I highly encourage anybody interested to get involved in some of the great volunteering that CEDIA does. I know it's certainly been enriching for me, and I enjoy it. For that, let's talk a little bit about surveillance. Now, I'm not going to give a comprehensive course here, but I'm going to talk about what the newer camera systems are about, how they're done. We're going to talk about the ways we record video and how the cloud has been affecting that of late. Look at some of the latest cameras that are out there. We'll even kind of look at the architecture of how you put these systems together and how to best do this. And finally, I want to talk about some analytics involving AI and various things about how we're analyzing the video and automating the alerts. And that, here's the deal. It's all digital. We've gotten away from composite video, the OSD analog cameras, very basically dead. It's hard to even find one these days. So older systems, we're upgrading with the HD analog systems, or we're putting in IP systems. The real differences here between these two is that HD analog, a little less expensive, and it will take advantage of using legacy coax that you have in. So if you've got a facility or a building and you just can't change the cameras, change the wiring, this is a good way to go. You don't need a bunch of adapters to try to do Ethernet over coax. But if you can replace cable, let's get out there and do the IP and network cameras, because we're going to get so many more features and the resolutions just keep going up on this stuff. Now, HD analog, it originally came out of the broadcast industry with a standard called high definition serial digital interface. Let them take coax that they had installed in the facilities and send their HD signals around the building. So what happened was the manufacturers looked at this and said, hey, that's a coax, that's digital, let's use that. And they adopted various methods. They're really very similar to each other. They're all based on this. Each has made improvements. The first of the three types was called analog HD. That's being used by Hanwha, which used to be Samsung, Digital Watchdog. It's kind of popular. It's out there, but it's not that popular, to be honest with you. The next one, CDI, is one that Dahoo has done, and their OEMs, one of their OEMs, for example, is IC Realtime. They've gotten out there pretty good with that. Then the most popular one I see out there is TVI. That was the one driven by Hikvision. And Hikvision has a whole bunch of OEMs as well that they also do it. The good news here is that everybody that's making DVRs in the encoders are pretty much making them universal, so they'll work with all types, including SD analog or your composite video cameras if you still got a few of those out there. So good news about that, but you need to pay attention. You need to make sure those are right. So HD analog is getting better. They've got it up to where we're looking at coax over about 1,500 feet. You know, the HD analog, it was only about 350, 400 feet, but you're getting long runs with this. So that's good when you've got something you're trying to compare to existing infrastructure. Resolutions, they're getting up to around 4K. There's a few at 4K. Most of them are in that 3 to 4 megapixel range. I haven't seen anything really beyond 4K. It's kind of a limit they're pushing there, and at the same time trying to keep the cost down. The other thing we see is they're starting to see a few new cameras come up where they're also allowing you to take that single coax and push power over it as well as the digital signal. So there's some features coming with that. I think it's declining because everybody's moving more and more toward the IP cameras in spite of the installed infrastructure. But it's still out there, and it's a good solution for the right application. My favorite, of course, IP network cameras. IP network cameras were invented by a company called Axis, AXIS, back in the late 90s, and have stayed with it. That's all they produce. They don't do any HD analog, and there are several other companies out there similarly as well that don't. But what is an IP network camera? You know, it's standard network over Cat 6, Cat 5. You don't really need 6A. We're not pushing that much. There's a typical camera is 4 to 5 megabits per second, depending on how much motion's in there, whether it's light or dark. So the worst case is about 5 megapixels on these cameras per second, or not megapixel, but megabits per second is a data rate. So you're dealing with a gigahertz network. You've got a lot of cameras you can play on that. So what we're seeing is 4K is really becoming commonplace. I think the sweet spot right now is about 4 megapixels in today, but this time next year, I think the sweet spot's going to be 4K. I'm expecting a lot more 4K cameras. I have a couple of manufacturers out there that are doing 10 megapixel, and there's one out there that's a 30 megapixel camera. Some really neat features you can do on it. And what's allowing all this to happen is we're moving from just a standard CPU in these things to a full graphic processing unit like you get in your gaming systems, like companies like NVIDIA make. And this really is starting to allow us to do some of the advanced analytics as well as get the data rates up. I mean, not the data rates, but the resolutions up. The encoding for these cameras, H.264, is pretty much standard. The H.265 is the newest, and we're increasingly seeing more and more in there. H.265 is getting us on average probably about 30-40% more compression ratio in there. The idea in a network cameras, they're doing it in the camera, so you're not putting all that load on the NVR. The really good thing I think is happening is the ONVIF, getting us the compatibility between somebody's VMS or NVR system and the camera. So if you're ONVIF compatible, pretty much guaranteed you'll get a video image, but that doesn't mean you'll get all the advanced features. And if you want those as part of your compatibility, be sure you check with the manufacturer and test those things with the camera and the NVR you're using. Another thing, most cameras are starting to do audio. In fact, two-way audio is pretty common. With you have to hook up an external speaker, but you know, we didn't see this a lot in the SD cameras at all. Another big feature that was happening when we started, these IP cameras, they were really bad about low light. You know, it just didn't do that well. The improvements they've made, the kind of processing they've done, the more processing power they put in the cameras, it could be totally dark outside, it seems like, and you'd still get a decent image to see, even without IR in color. And the other one is wide dynamic range. Wide dynamic range is that situation where, you know, I've got a very bright, like I'm standing inside a garage and I'm looking out, and the garage is bright outside, but it's relatively dark compared to that inside the garage. And the camera's trying to decide, well, what do I focus on? Well, the true WDR camera knows how to average that and still get you a good image. And we're seeing that's really stepping up in these cameras. Rare to find a camera without IR in it now that's built in to the camera. There's still external IR if you need it for some long range applications. You need a lot more IR, you can get it. But rare to find one not built in. Recording. We can record in the camera. A lot of these cameras come with SD cards, slots in them. But I caution you, not SD cards they're constantly being recorded on an SD, the technology in SD cards. They've only got so many cycles that they can read and write. So caution on that. Make sure you get a good SD card, and it's probably best to use it as backup. But it's there, and it's a great feature to have. DVRs, this is what we associate with our HD analog cameras that we have out there now. NVRs are cameras, are IP camera appliances. You know, they're a computer, but they made by the manufacturer, loaded with their BMS software on it, and it's basically ready to go. Hook it up to the network, put the addresses on there, and you're pretty much ready to go. And they give you some extended warranties and stuff for doing it that way. The other alternative is you just get their software or their VMS and you load it onto your own server. These are typically dedicated in that application, but you can go get like an HP or a Dell server or something and load the software on it, and then you manage the licensing and stuff. The last method is a cloud. Why do I need NVR or VMS on site or server? I don't need all that. I just push it to the cloud. Well, you do have a little bit of a bandwidth limitation. We're talking about upload here, not download speed. So there's really three types here. There's managed. That means that I'm managing even multiple sites and I'm doing it through the cloud, and I'm talking and working with the recorders that are on site, the servers, the NVRs, the VMSs that are on site. In a hosted situation, we're pushing it all to the cloud. Now, you'll find this common with cameras like the Nest, the Ring cameras, some of those stuff like that. It's pretty common to push that up to the cloud and do it that way. But more, if you get more than a few cameras, it gets to be a little bit impractical to do it that way. Some of the best solutions are the hybrid solutions, where we'll take some very select cameras and we'll push those to the cloud, but yet still have an on-site recorder. I think that's probably the best. If you've done some camera systems like I do, where I get into the 60 to 100 cameras, imagine trying to push all that up to a cloud and do that. Not gonna happen, not at least today. Will it happen? I'm not gonna say it's not, but it's gonna take a lot of upspeed bandwidth to do that. We'll see how that goes and keep an eye on that. Cameras, well, they're improving all the way around, but the standard types are still pretty common. The box camera, you usually get really good performance, great lenses in these cameras. Standard little small cameras we'll use indoors, like the mini bullets, the turrets, the mini domes. That mini dome's got IR in it for inside. The dome is standard. The bullets do a little better with IR outside than the camera, than the domes. It's just the way that the LEDs are placed in there and how they work within the structure of those cameras. Now, IR is getting out there in these PTZs, which was very uncommon a few years ago. We're looking at a couple of hundred meters, pretty common on these cameras. That's 600 feet, guys. That's pretty good out there for those cameras. The newer types, we have what we call a multi-sensor camera. You'll notice it also has IR. The multi-sensor camera is four cameras in one. Each one of these can be moved around this circumference here. They can be positioned, tilted, twisted, turned, and pointed in a particular direction. Some of them have motorized mechanisms that will actually tilt and move those things. I would be careful of those because they're still early in the stage and the mechanics on that, something that I've seen prone to failure. But the nice thing about this one network camera, I've got four views I can get. One of those views could zoom in on a gate. The others could take some wide views. They work really well if you got like some 270, 180 coverage. You need to look down so that part that you get cut off because the camera's looking out, you can't see below. Now you can do that. The things we're doing with fisheye cameras and their 360 views, the ability to dewarp these cameras, the software that's doing that is really amazing. You can go from something like you see here on the left do a dual 180 view or quad view and get the whole place out there. These are really getting good. I'm seeing them in about 12 megapixels, so there's a good resolution on them. One of the newer applications is taking, and this is all from COVID, is taking our thermal cameras that obviously are measuring heat and using those. They take a black body calibrator as the reference standard to get the temperature, and then are measuring temperature so they can decide whether you may have fever or not. That's really been a hot seller right here in this market. I did a podcast on this with CEDIA if you want to look it up and get more information about it. It's pretty interesting stuff. New video phones. Yes, video phones. You don't have to have a box inside the house. It can come to your iPhone. We have the standalone types. These don't integrate well. They're standalone. They're inexpensive. They work okay. You know, you got a good, reasonably good Wi-Fi. You need that. Then you have the pro models. These will integrate companies like 2N, Doorbird, Sidel. They'll integrate with our major control systems from the Crestron's Control 4, Savant's, Lines, and those things like that. So, and they have a little bit more aesthetic look than you'll find in some of the other stuff. System architecture, just a brief note on this. You'll notice one thing that I'm doing here, and I have an isolated network that I'm putting my cameras on. The reason I do that is if you take that bandwidth and you put that all on your main network, you get over 10 or 12 cameras, you can bog your network down. You know, that's always going, that's always sending data. So by isolating it, you get that off there. The second thing is we get an extra layer of security with our cameras. You can't get to my cameras by scanning my network. You have to come through my NVR, which has a layer of security, and then the cameras all have their own passcodes as well. So to get remote access, you come in through the NIC, second NIC on these NVRs, and that'll take you right to viewing your cameras because you're looking at the server. Now, I always try to put TeamViewer on these things. Some of them come with it. That way, if I want to, I can remote desktop into this server, and I can do all my camera management, direct camera management I want without having to come through this network. So just a word on architecture, something I think is good for you to do. Let's spend a couple of minutes on video analytics. Well, the basics are video motion was the original sort of analytics. It was based on, you know, you went from frame number one to frame number two, it compared the two and said, what was the difference in pixels? How many changed? And what rate did they change at? Something like that. So you're just literally looking at how many pixels changed. And the problem is it had a pretty high false rate because you have things like, branch blowing in the wind, some little animal coming by. You can't discern the difference. Now, when we started moving into a little more sophisticated analytics, what we said was let's do object detection. Now, to do object detection, we're saying, what was the difference in those pixels? What was the content change that was there? And how can we use that to classify an object? You know, you can look at things like, the size of the object, how did it move, the duration, those kind of things like that can actually make a difference. You could improve it by using some calibration and telling it to ignore certain things as clouds, birds, trees, just doing a little calibration on it. You can select a particular area of interest and that will help. Other examples that we use this a lot, like perimeter detection, instead of having beams out there, we can actually tell it where we want it to go. That's kind of like a tripwire, but we can set a perimeter around the building. Object left behind, or object removed, you can look at that. Somebody going the wrong direction. Numerous things like this that we can look at once we classify an object and where it's going. Now we get into the more sophisticated stuff, which is the artificial intelligence. We'll classify that as machine learning and deep learning. That's the kind of two areas that we've thought about this. In a machine learning situation, basically we're setting up an algorithm with some pre-programmed rules, if you will, that classify an object. They tell us what kind of object it is. So if we're looking for a person, it can say, well, that's a person, not a car. And we know that because we've taken this algorithm that knows how to determine that. Deep learning, on the other hand, says, I'm gonna make up my own rules. But to do that, you gotta train me by sending me a whole bunch of data on each object type. So you'll send it lots and lots of different data sets that are on there. Every type of person that you can see, size, you know, race, culture, you know, lots of different things on that to find that in there. Our cars versus trucks versus SUVs and those things like that. So you send it large data sets, and it takes and uses its filters and it builds its rule sets based on that comparative learning that it's doing between those different objects. Deep learning AI is usually better done in the camera. Now, you that sounds counterintuitive, but if you think about it, if I'm sending a bunch of cameras information, their raw video information, to a server to do the video analytics, I got to have a bunch of these GPUs in there to handle it because I got a whole bunch of cameras coming at me. It's a lot of processing load that's in there, and you're putting it all on that server, and you're putting it on your network as well. So the idea of putting GPUs in the cameras, beefing that up, only working with a single image, so you got sort of you can kind of control that, is where we see a lot of that going. And more of the cameras are coming that do this are coming with high processing and doing it in cameras. We see that as the best trend. Now, the second thing we see here is facial recognition. I'm sure some of you have seen some of this. Your iPhones are starting to do that now, and we've seen it. There's three elements to this stuff. Face detection, the old saying, you know, before I can recognize somebody, I got to determine that it's face. So we start there. You need good lighting. Obviously, it's best if it's a direct view of the face. You know, if you're looking at sideways or off axis and stuff like that, that can cause problems with your facial recognition system. Now, there's verification. Okay, I've got a photo of you that is supposed to match you, and does that match? So we're doing a one-to-one match. I have an expected photo, and then I'm matching it to a picture I'm taking of you. That's face verification. And identification, which is much harder to do, you identify a person from many different faces, like in a crowd or you know, we just don't know who you are, but we're trying to scan you and find you in a database. So one of the criteria here is, and I've used this term before, of pixels per foot. It's how much resolution we get on a face. Now, obviously, the further away you get away from the camera, the less pixels I have on your face. The wider angle I make the camera, the less pixels I get on the face. So just to give you a reference point, I design my systems to around 50 pixels per foot. I can pretty much, as a human, tell who it is. The FBI says I need 75 in a court of law to perfectly identify that person. What they're saying with really good accurate recognition needs a pretty close up view from the camera, and we're in the range of 90 to 100 pixels per foot. Okay, so just to give you an idea of what they're doing now. Then they get into this whole thing of liveness detection. Can you spoof that camera by putting a photo up in front of it? The way they get around that is they use what's called a 3D depth map. This is what Apple is doing right now with most of their stuff. That gets you pretty high accuracy, but pretty high recognition without spoofing or without any problems of being faked. You can also use a number of other things. Even blinking can make a difference in how you do that. the trends in video analytics, I'm really, really encouraged by what's happening here. Video analytics is solving the problem, really, that, you know, some guy sitting there trying to watch 20 or 30 cameras 24/7 or on his 8-hour shift or whatever. And we all know as humans, you're not going to be very good at that. Instead, if we can send you an alert, wake you up, say, hey, focus on this item right now. There's something happening. We've got better security and better situations and better utilization of our surveillance system as an early warning system. It's getting good. It's getting good. The false rates are going down, but I still have to give you caution. Even if you get one or two falses a week, send that to your owner and see how much they like that. They're going to start, this thing don't work. They're trying to turn around. It's not true. I look it up. There's a raccoon running through my backyard. Well, just use caution. What I would recommend you do is sell video analytics, but be sure you do it with remote monitoring or someone in between the owner and that system to validate those alerts. Most of your security companies, your security monitoring companies, they're starting to do video monitoring as well. Most of the major ones are doing it. Rapid Response is one, was the early players in that. Cops monitoring, I don't know who's in your areas, but it's becoming pretty commonplace to find that they can validate these alarms. They have good software that works with that. As far as the number of cameras that have this built into it with the real deep learning, the really advanced stuff, there's a handful out there. They're expensive, but they're getting better. And they're things like a few years ago, 4K cameras were very expensive, but not so much anymore today. I expect by 2024, 2025, we're going to see this as a real common feature in it to have very strong, good analytics in the cameras. And even if you look out beyond that, you're going to see this thing be able to actually classify it. I love the example. It says, you know, a car is a 90s vintage Ferrari. It's not just a car. It's a 90s vintage Ferrari. You can do something like that. So that's where I think it's going. And I think that's some of the great stuff that's happening. Appreciate your time. Hope it wasn't too long for you. Please contact me if you have questions. I'll do my doggone best to answer you. Have a great show. Thank you.